So now we're going to talk to Terry about his new play, Billy and Me.
In addition to being a prolific critic, the biographer of both Louis Armstrong and Duke Ellington, Terry has figured in recent years into playwriting. His Satchmo at the Waldorf has been produced in New York and all across the country. And now with his second play, which starts performances in West Palm Beach on December 8th, he's absorbing us in the lives of famous men of the theater. Now, Terry, can you tell us a little bit about the new play?
Sure. Billy and Me is a two-act, three-man, four-character play about the relationship between William Inge and Tennessee Williams. It's also a history play, but of a very particular kind. It portrays matters of historical fact about which our actual knowledge is limited. The first act takes place in a bar in Chicago on New Year's Eve, 1944. At that time, Inge was a drama critic in St. Louis. He's come to Chicago to review the out-of-town tryout of the original production of The Glass Menagerie, after which he meets Williams to talk about the show. We know that he was overwhelmed by the experience and that it inspired him to become a playwright, but that's all we know. The rest, as I say in the title page, is fiction freely based on fact. And the second act takes place 15 years later in Inge's New York apartment, a few hours after the opening night performance of his first flop, A Loss of Roses. He's just read the reviews, and I'll let you imagine what happens after that. All I'll say is that Billy and Me, unlike some small cast plays, is very eventful.
It sounds totally intriguing, and a theater audience will eat it up, it sounds like. How has rehearsal been going for you this time? Is it a different process the second time around?
Not really, no. We, just as was the case with Satchmo at the Waldorf, the play has been workshopped. We came in with the script in pretty good shape, but you never know where you are until you get going. We spent the first week doing what's called table work, read through the script, looked for problem areas. I did rewrites every night. By the end of the week, we were ready to go with what we call the memorization draft. And it's fun. I think people forget there's a reason why we call these things plays. You are spending the day working very, very hard, 6 to 8 hours of straight work, but it's totally immersing, involving, exciting, and it's a lot of fun.
Mm.
Well, one of the things I'm very curious about, like one of the criticism that's often hurled at critics is that, well, if you've never done it, how can you review it? I, for instance, have never written a word of fiction. I've tried, and I can tell you it's appalling. So I'm going to spare the world my feeble attempts. But, first of all, I don't think that's a valid criticism. But you, as a person doing both, how does one inform the other?
Well, Kenneth Tynan actually had a really good line about this. He said that a critic is somebody who can read a map but doesn't know how to drive the car.
Right.
Yeah, and let's remember
his
contribution to the canon. I think didn't he write "Old Calcutta"?
Right, indeed. I mean, that's a funny line, but like all funny lines, there is some truth embedded in it. I mean, by writing plays and helping to bring them to the stage, both as an author and last year I started directing as well, I've learned from hands-on experience things about the art of theater that I would have found hard to learn in any other way.
Like what?
Well, for one thing, I've learned about the nuts and bolts of play construction.
Mm.
I've also learned how to see stage direction in a different way. I mean, especially when you are seeing a new play or you're seeing a play for the first time, the text and the staging are coming at you in one indissoluble unit.
Right.
It's like listening to a record of a piece of orchestra music and you can't see the conductor.
You know, one of the things I am always curious about, and Elisabeth, I'm sure you have the same issue, is how much, when you see a play that you don't particularly like or that you love, how much credit to apportion to the direction versus the script. We tend, when things don't go right, we tend to blame the writer. And I don't know if that's because critics, you know, by nature understand the written word better than they understand direction as a you know, just relatively speaking. And what you're describing, Terry, seems to me a finer understanding of the sort of the integration of those two efforts. Has that helped you as a reviewer?
I don't know. I mean, I know that I sometimes see shows now And I know that I'm seeing something up there that I wouldn't have seen otherwise. Typically, that has to do with the directing process more than anything else. When you are seeing a new play for the first time, you really have to be, you have to be modest about your ability to tease these elements apart. That's one of the reasons, by the way, why I make a point of reviewing regional productions of plays that I've seen for the first time in New York, because I want to see them done differently. And for me, a very big and important part of this experience of becoming a playwright is that I have now seen one of my plays, Satchmo at the Waldorf, done in a half dozen different ways, by different actors, by different directors, radically different, and I encourage this.
I actually have a very practical, very practical, basic question. So Satchmo at the Waldorf was done in New York, and you also review a lot of shows in New York. How do you negotiate the potential conflicts of interest?
You simply have to be open with your newspaper, the journal, and as aware as possible of it. I don't, obviously, if you direct my show, I won't review anything that you direct for a couple of years after your involvement with the show ends. If your company does my show, I won't review anything that your company does for a couple of years after your involvement ends. If you are one of the designers, I won't mention your work for a couple of years. And I always tell the journal, look, so-and-so is the set designer on this play. He designed my play, so I'm not going to be mentioning him. In the case of Satchmo, the actor was John Douglas Thompson. He's quite well known. And so when he...
And busy.
And so when he came to New York and performed, we sent my alternate, Ed Rothstein, to review the production. I just felt that I couldn't possibly comment on a show in which John played a major role.
So here, the question I'm sure people listening want to know is, do you read your reviews?
Why, hell no.
But you have a sense of how people have responded, no? I mean,
sure.
It has to be in the air, right?
You can't not know that, because it has to do with how the box office is doing. But I always tell theater people, don't read your reviews. They're not written for you. And it seems to me just plain common sense to take my own advice.
Okay, and now... Now I have a question for Peter. Peter, would you review Terry's show?
Oh, that's a great question. Well, you know, that is a really, you know, obviously now that I really am getting to know Terry, it would be really difficult.
I don't think it would be appropriate for you to do that now that we're working together on a podcast.
I would not. I could not.
I mean, now that we're doing this together, and you know, we're
even
know,
before it would have been before.
Yes, even
the
before,
podcast would
not,
have been a little tricky, but now, for me, it would be a no.
Yeah, well, Terry, what is you going to say? You had a thought about that?
Well, when the times when Satchmo came to Off Broadway, I don't know Ben Brantley well, but I know him. I mean, we've been on television together. We see each other on the aisle, and they decided that they felt they needed to go to an outside reviewer to write about the show. I think maybe that's a bit over-scrupulous, but I do understand why they would have done that, and I'm fine with that.
Well, listen, Terry, we of course, even if we don't review, we send you our best wishes for this production, and we're eager to see it, even if we don't review it, and maybe at some point we can all do a podcast with drinking martinis on the beach in Palm Beach. I think that'd be a really nice...
I would love that.
Yeah, maybe that's what we should do in
Shirley Temple for me.
I myself hope that it comes a little closer to you than that eventually, but we'll see.
All right, so thanks, Terry.